The medieval and adjacent time periods were just made for gaming. Hi folks, it's Falcon, and today on Gameranx, 10 medieval games that you need to try out in 2018. Number 10 is Graveyard Keeper, a game that would be hard to explain if it were not for Stardew Valley, which you could basically say this is a lot like Stardew Valley, but for medieval graveyards. The game bills itself as the most inaccurate medieval cemetery management sim of all time, and that sense of humor tends to pervade most of the game. The idea is you have to build and manage your graveyard, but also find corners to cut that allow you to bring down costs. For instance, one of the things they circulate regularly is an animation of throwing a body into a river, which is gloriously animated. The goal is obviously to expand, and to do that you also have to scare nearby villagers into attending church, so when they die, they'll be buried at your church. It's all a gross, exploitative cycle, and we look forward to exactly how deep it goes. We'll find out in August, when Graveyard Keeper comes out for PC and Xbox One this year. Number 9 is Dark Souls Remastered. If you haven't already played Dark Souls, I don't really know what to tell you other than it is a very hard game that takes the action RPG to a very specific realm. It has a flow to combat that is absolutely unique, at least to the point that it is considered ubiquitous. There is a Dark Souls style game, which is very precision oriented and depends on strategy and timing in a way that a lot of games do not. This brings a few pretty good graphical improvements, for instance, better textures, better lighting effects, and of course a stable 60 frames per second. Also, the way networking works in this game is better. It's more reminiscent of Bloodborne and Dark Souls 3. And if you haven't played this game, this is the best way to play it. If you have and want to go back through it, again, best way to play it. It's out on pretty much everything too. Number 8 is Eitr, a game that is based in a dark fantasy medieval world in which you take the role of the Shield Maiden as she uses a variety of different weapons and strategies to unravel the mystery of her fate in 9 Norse worlds. So what we basically have here is pixel art, Norse mythology, kinda Dark Souls-y looking gameplay. It has that very deliberate feel to it, at least from what I've observed, which is of course a big deal to anybody looking for a new Dark Souls style game. But of course it is also quite different, as we're not often playing from an isometric perspective. It also really has its own very unique look as far as the pixel art goes, managing to stand out in a frankly very crowded quadrant of style. If this game plays half as good as it looks like it will, when it comes to PS4, Windows, and Linux, as well as Mac later in the year, I think we'll all be addicted. Number 7 is Mordhau, a game that was kickstarted as a skill-based medieval fighting game played from the first-person perspective with a deep level of customization. One of the things the developers have talked about is making it possible to express yourself with the combat of the game, meaning they intend for a very fluid, customizable combat experience. And watching a lot of the footage, it looks like they've gotten a lot of it right. However, we do know that Kingdom Come Deliverance tried very similar things, which ended up being to some degree a success and to some not. Mordhau takes a multiplayer melee angle with 64 player skirmishes, attempting to slot itself in purely as a multiplayer game, and that could very well be the thing that makes it work. Mordhau is coming either Q3 or Q4 this year to the PC. Number 6 is Ancestor's Legacy, a squad-based real-time strategy that takes a broad tactical focus with an emphasis on inspiration specifically from medieval history. Visually speaking, this is a gorgeous game. Anytime there is fire, it really excels as well. Looks very stylized and cool. The single-player campaign is pretty darn big and is inspired, like I said, by historical events. There are 4 different nations to choose from, and all in all, the game sort of combines the best elements from a few different games, but there's a particular Middle Earth influence you will note. Ancestor's Legacy is out as of now on PC. It also launched very recently on the Xbox One and has been regarded quite well. It is a fun game, but more than that, it feels like a streamlined, well-thought-out experience. Number 5 is Foundation, a game that I think pretty cleverly redefines exactly what a city-building simulation is. You see, it's only until very recently that grids have been used in city planning. Before that, it was kind of just a, whatever, let's build a city type situation. They're calling it an organic city development simulation, but are also emphasizing monument construction and resource management, as well as morph tools that allow for buildings to change shape as you build them in between other areas that require different shapes. It's a pretty unique take on the city builder, and obviously we're interested in how it turns out. The game should be coming to early access on PC in October. Number 4 is Warhammer Vermintide 2, a pretty wild first-person, very melee-based first-person combat game that almost doesn't need a description as to why it is a good co-op game. When looking at the action from this game, it is blistering, it's high impact, it flows incredibly well. The game definitely leans toward melee combat, but all of its various projectiles are interesting. It throws quite a variety of weapons and tools at you in order to complete the objectives at hand, and because of that sort of mix and match element of the game, having several friends playing it at once just meshes in such a fun, weirdly arcadey kind of way, despite it not really being a terribly arcadey game. Warhammer Vermintide 2 is out on PC now, and will be out on PS4 and Xbox One later in the year. Number 3 is Total War Saga Thrones of Britannia, which brings a lot of streamlining to the Total Wars franchise, but the thing that they do right is place an emphasis on these incredibly tense, huge battles that definitely work out in a manner that stays true to the Total War franchise. It's kind of Total War if Total War was more breakneck in pacing. And I think that that's a positive thing because history has a tendency to get historical. This game focuses on the action parts, the reasons why you would play the type of game that you're playing, and I think comes out much stronger for it. It's already out, it's on PC, and you can get it whenever you want. Number 2 is Kingdom Come Deliverance, a game that I think has gotten some deserved criticism and a little bit of undeserved criticism. It has been clunky. Let's not pretend that it is not clunky. But it is an impressive and ambitious game that managed to pull off a lot of what it tried to do. Also, a lot of the problems being talked about in most of the online discussion I've seen of this game has been fixed. And they've also released a DLC roadmap that shows us there's a lot down the road. The idea was to make something like Skyrim or Witcher without any of the fantasy elements, just a pure medieval version of that. And frankly, it works. It's not the perfect version of itself yet, but I think it's going to be, and I think it could be quite a good franchise. I've enjoyed it. It's out on PS4, Xbox One, and Microsoft Windows right now. And finally, number 1 is Age of Empires Definitive Edition, the classic from 1997 reimagined with better graphics, better music, and a much smoother user interface that doesn't feel alienating for fans of the original, but just works better. Everything about it just works better. And yes, there are some issues that were present in the original game that there's no real reason to get, in my opinion, too upset about. A game designed in 1997 with pathfinding issues of the day shouldn't be expected not to have those issues now. One could even say that might fundamentally change the game in a way that might not make it the same game, which makes it debatable whether or not they should do a remaster. The quirks of older games are really what makes them worth going back to. This is absolutely the game that it was, with a few minor improvements. And in my opinion, that's a good thing, but it may not be everyone's opinion. That said, it is really one of the forerunners of the genre, and I think you get a lot out of playing it one way or the other. Age of Empires Definitive Edition is out now on Windows. And a quick bonus game for you, Divinity Original Sin 2 is a tactical turn-based RPG. Now, the game itself did come to PC in 2017, but it's coming out on PS4 and Xbox One later in the year. Divinity Original Sin 2 is an awesome game. It's in a lot of ways along the style of the sort of Pillars of Eternity, Torment, sort of revival of the CRPG of the 90s. But it's such a good example that I'd say it's easily among the best of that. It has a great plot that takes place in the same world a few centuries after the first game, and frankly, if you like CRPGs or even like XCOM, this is a joy to play. It's coming to Xbox One and PlayStation 4 in August, and I can tell you I will be playing it again on console. It's a good game. What's your favorite medieval game that you've already played this year or that you're planning to play later in the year? Leave us a comment, let us know, and if you like this video, please click like. If you're not subscribed, now would be the best time to do so. We upload brand new videos every day of the week, and the best way to see see them first is, of course, a subscription. As always, thank you very much for watching this video. I'm Falcon. You can follow me on Twitter @FalconTheHero. We'll see you next time, right here on Gameranx.